Welcome to Slash Forward. In this episode, we're going to evaluate the efficacy of mass transit in New York City with the Clive Barker adaptation, Midnight Meat Train. Leave a comment with your most harrowing subway story and consider subscribing to the channel for more. Let's get to it. We open on a man's pores as he rests on an empty subway car. When he attempts to head for another car, he's stopped by a slippery puddle of viscous fluid that he discovers to be blood. As he makes his slow realization, he glances ahead and witnesses a man in the process of butchering. And then we pull back on Bradley C., staring into our very souls with the eyes of an artist. He arrives home as Maya finishes her studies and is disgruntled that he may not have captured the sort of bloody, salacious scenes they would be most likely to accept at the Post. Maya offers another possible outlet for his photography, OnlyFans, and also she pulled some strings and got him a meeting with the Susan Hoff, which is a tremendous treat for any up-and-coming artist. Leon arrives at her office the next day with their common friend, Jurgis, to discuss his portfolio, which he plops down onto the table. Her response is steeped in pretentious pop art psychobabble.
It's melodrama. Arresting, but empty.
But she does encourage him to go deeper, to linger longer, and really get to the dirty interior of the city. So he goes home to sleep and dreams of bloody meat hooks, causing him to wake up and realize it's now the witching hour. As a result, he gets to work, submerging himself into the seedy underbelly of the city to capture its realness. When he hears some shenanigans in the subway, he hurries down to frame out the fantastic scene. However, upon recognizing the actual suffering in the victim's eyes, he does end up intervening, pulling a Kevin on the assailant by basically daring him to do anything in front of the CCTV. The assailant ponders the risks of keeping it real, ultimately deciding to move along. Leon rushes to her to explain how good this will be for his art, but she has to hurry to make her train. And as she rocks out to what sounds like a Keen song, a man walks up slowly behind her to tenderize her head, an apt metaphor. The next day, Maya peeps new shots and is thrilled that her creative man has got his touch back. Later, Leon visits her at the Greasy Spoon Diner where she's employed, and as the line cook graciously heats up his block of bean curds, he comes across a news report indicating his subject has gone missing, so he immediately runs off to share his shots with the cops like a snitch. The detective confusingly flips the script on him, however, questioning what he was doing down there and wondering what his intent was, leaving him to walk off feeling like he had just been scolded. Back at the studio, the Hoff is absolutely blown away. She even gives him a whoa.
I haven't said it since high school.
She agrees that if he can bring back two more shots of this quality, she'll put him in her next show. Then the whole wrecking crew has some celebratory drinks before he ducks out to capture his images. Down in the bowels of the city, a couple of business bros try to convince Lee that the train is perfectly safe, but they don't heed her warnings quickly enough, resulting in Randall getting his eyeballs knocked out and Johnson getting his gooch hooked. Lee is then dragged off to slaughter, where we're treated to an interesting POV shot of her own beheading, pulling back on her body as her soul departs this realm. Leon missed that shot, but is posted up on a bench nearby when the meat man emerges from the underground escalator. So primal and perfect, his mere presence is violent enough to warrant a few photos. He follows, but turns the corner to discover that he's been discovered. Leon tries to play it cool and walk on, but his quarry stops him, causing him to immediately turtle and present himself, becoming so submissive and inconsequential that he's let go. Later in his dark room, he's able to connect this interaction with the disappearance of his prior subject via the very unique ring the man had. So now he's on it, working to find and follow the man as he goes about his daily business, discovering his business to be that of packing meat. After putting in an honest day's labor, he leaves, and Leon is waiting. He follows him into the subway and waits on him all night until they get to the final train, which the butcher enters. Leon, however, is held from following when an officer under orange alert decides to search his camera for concealed explosives. This leaves the butcher to his evening ritual, waiting until they take the red line to hell and murdering whoever comes. This time, however, he's delayed by some GI trouble, resulting in a bit more back and forth and requiring the conductor to intervene on his behalf. Through this, we do learn the butcher's name is Mahogany, which is fairly masculine. Back at the diner, Leon slips into the back like a murderer, but instead he gives Maya a pre-engagement engagement ring. It's a promise that they may one day be committed, at some point in the future. In celebration of this, Leon presses her face down onto the countertop and unromantically jerks himself into her, which she seems to appreciate. We then find ourselves back on the train with another cool POV shot that implies Leon is the butcher, and then he wakes up. Meanwhile, we watch as Mahogany drops that skincare routine, which involves shaving off several of the fungus-like nipples that cover most of his torso, saving them for later as you can blend them into a paste, making a fine nutrient-dense treat. Maya notices Leon's new pictures, but doesn't want him becoming entangled in dangerous business. She suggests he give one to the cops and move on, but he's enamored with the mystery and spends some time connecting some dots in the microfiche. He even goes into the guy's work, stealing a butcher's uniform so he can get an on-the-ground view of how they do what they do, while shooting discreetly from the crotch. But he is noticed and forced to run. He ends up among the many hanging half-beefs in the storage cooler, where they play a brief but dangerous game of hide-and-seek before he finds a door and hitches a ride on the back of a truck. Leon then goes to where he can be cozy and familiar and ends up craving his buddy's meat. Please stop that. After finishing his steak, he goes home where Maya is increasingly concerned with his obsession. He believes he's got it all figured out with his pinned map and his news clippings from 80 years ago. She pleads that he gives up his ambitions and stick to day shoots to show that he loves her, and even offers a bit of portraiture to cleanse the palate. But Mahogany's deep in there, and he finds that he simply must scratch that itch. But instead, he actually meets her at the diner later to confirm that she was right the whole time. Only problem is that now, his obsession is following him. So he goes with him to the train and waits in an adjacent car to see what's up. They ride until they get to the final loop of the night and head down the forbidden track. This time, when he gets to beating on folks with his hammer, Leon is hiding nearby, working up the courage to shoot it. Here we see Mahogany carefully stores their clothing by category and meticulously disassembles their bodies before hanging them out to dry. Then he notices he's being filmed. Leon attempts to run but makes the mistake of going to the front of the train, and he gets no cooperation from the conductor. He wakes up from this to find himself upside down, except all his parts are intact, and then he gets his body all scratched up by some sort of body scratching demon. When he wakes up again, he's clothed in an abandoned station below the slaughterhouse. He's not sure what happened, but he knows he don't feel right. He wanders home, but is so out of it he declines to acknowledge Maya's even there. And that's the woman he nearly committed to, so you know it's serious. He's too busy scoping out damn titties, which have been marred with some sort of symbol. When he comes out, he tells her about everything he saw, but violently declines to go to the police or take an ambulance, afraid they'll assume he was responsible for anything they may happen to find since his camera is now missing. So his plan is to get some rest and enjoy the exhibition that evening. With few other options, Maya drags Jurgis into the lion's den to attempt to retrieve the camera. They find their way in and set to searching the modest apartment. And as Maya scopes out his extensive nipple collection, he returns. Jurgis finds the camera but is crept upon, and Maya emerges to find the butcher's bag full of sweet, sweet evidence, confirming things they already had a pretty good idea about. She tucks it away for later and approaches what she presumes to be Jurgis, unresponsive and taking a break in the closet. But it is not, and she correctly guesses this, dipping out and leaving her friend to his wretched fate. She ends up at the police station where she hears the report back from the field as the apartment was clean. They consider dropping charges against her so long as she returns the homeowner's property. Subway timetables corresponding with murders going back 100 years. With the hair on her neck tingling again, she feigns ignorance of its whereabouts and storms off. We then transition to Leon's exhibit where Susan teaches him how to schmooze potential buyers. But after getting caught in the alluring gaze of his favorite subject, it dawns on him what he must do.
I got a train to catch.
Maya, meanwhile, runs back to the diner to borrow Sal's gun. In the alley behind the restaurant, the detective again insists on getting her hands on that booklet. Maya instead insists on being told the whereabouts of Jurgis, and it's revealed that he's on the train. So now, they're all converging on their destiny simultaneously, with Leon taking just a short break to suit up along the way. As the train passes, we come to realize that Leon's plan was just to hook onto a passing car and hop aboard, like a Looney Tune. Meanwhile, Maya has found the slaughter car where Jurgis is still alive, because Mahogany has many bodies to get through. She tries to get him down, requiring her to bear hug his crotch. And the noise alerts the butcher, who tosses his hammer into Maya's back and is just about to finish the job when Leon finally arrives. They're looking to have a final showdown, and he peekaboos around this guy's bare ass before they go at it, resulting in all kinds of collateral visceral spray. Eventually, and after some effort, Leon is able to eject him from the car. Then the two lovers embrace as they reach the end of the line and the rail cars come to a stop. The conductor requests they step off, and they find themselves in an underground cavern of sorts where a gang of Morlocks are fed from the meat of the victims. Outside the train, Mahogany is still alive, so they continue their fight, during which Leon recognizes they have the same scarification on their chests. He has been deemed the replacement and fully steps into the role with Mahogany's consent. The conductor then reveals this was all a test to make sure Leon had what it takes to do the job. Since he does, he gets his tongue ripped out out and munched upon. Then, in the final moments of exposition, we learn there's a cabal of powerful people hiding and nurturing these demons to keep them separate from the rest of the world, so this job is a necessary evil. Then, to sever any final ties, he splits Maya open and plays around with her insides. The next morning, the orientation handbook is turned over to the new butcher, who goes about his daily business as is their way. And we eventually come to find that it's Leon, butchering the guy from the opening and being revealed as though this turn presents any sort of a surprise. I have a website set up where you can support the channel through donations or merch. I'd like to take a moment to give a huge thanks to my donors, memorialized in the Hall of Headshots. It's always nice to get a decent Clive Barker adaptation. While this film isn't Hellraiser, what really is? Speaking of which, do you think there's been a better or more faithful adaptation of one of his stories? Let me know in the comments below. And if you enjoyed the video, I'd love for you to become a part of the channel by subscribing. Thanks for watching.